Hi, I'm Andres. I work at Citus Data. About half my time is spent on Postgres, where I'm a relatively long-term by now contributor and committer. The other half is spent working on Citus, a distributed layer on top of Postgres. And what I want to talk about today is how to make query execution faster. And like to start out, why did I want to make query execution faster? It's largely because I was seeing comparison with other databases, and in some workloads, Postgres performed very, very comparable. In other workloads, not so much. So since I work with Postgres, I like Postgres, I didn't like the not so much part. So I wanted to improve upon that. And as I said, Postgres, there's like some axes along which we perform well enough. There's some other axes where we don't work that well, and just to define along which we are talking about, there's a couple things when we talk about performance, efficiency, and it's all a bit wishy-washy, but so I'm going to define how I mean these. So scalability is usually the property that you can add either more resources, and can do more work. You, in common computer, like computers, you can either add, for example, more cores to the computer, or you can add more computers. I'm not really talking a lot about scalability today. What I'm talking more about is efficiency. How can we do more work with a given set of resources? At the moment, for example, if we disable parallelism and have a query that runs a single core, we don't use that core very efficiently. And there's other database products that can do so more efficiently for some workloads. And another property is concurrency. How much work can you do in parallel? I'm also not going to talk a lot about that. So really, my focus today is like about efficiency. So what kind of workloads are we like very, very roughly talking about today that like a reasonable number of people are hitting with Postgres? One very common one is OLTP. Another one is OLAP and hashtable. Online transaction processing, OLTP, is basically when you have very, very short transactions that do very few writes, do a few reads, and that is where Postgres generally performs very well. We scale well, there's some issues, but in general, it works pretty well. And that's none of the performance benefits that I'm talking today will benefit this in a meaningful manner. There's some minor benefits, but it's not a lot. Then there's online analytics processing, which is basically you have a bit more complicated queries. Your queries run longer. Every query analyzes a lot of data. You do aggregates over that data and then display that result. That's a lot of the queries that I'm talking about will, like, the improvements will help a lot there. And then what is becoming more and more hip and common is that you do try to do both analytic and transactional processing in the same database. And that's also why it's like kind of interesting for a database that is more focused onto the transactional processing side of things to also be good at analytics, because people don't want to have a different data store necessarily for both your transactional and non-transactional workload. So to understand a lot of the problems and benefits and difficulties of making things faster, one of the first things we have to understand is, unfortunately, relatively theoretical, and that's a pretty important property called Amdahl's law. So if you assume that we have like a piece of work that consists out of two parts, and by the way, I've just cribbed this from Wikipedia, the graph, because I'm bad at graphs, so I copied an even worse graph from Wikipedia. If you just assume that we have a piece of work, this is supposed to be red.
It's not red on the projector.
Yes, I'm noticing that. In theory, this is red and blue, so I'm calling it A and B. If you have a piece of work that consists of two parts, and piece A takes a more time than piece B, and we make piece B a lot faster, 5x, and making software a piece of software 5x faster is really a lot of work in law most of the time, then the total amount of time that we saved in relation to the total amount of time taken is actually not that much, because we made it 5 times faster, before that it was maybe 1/5 of the time. So the total resulting time that we saved is not actually that large. And if we instead make the part of the system that takes a lot of time only a bit faster, or 2x faster in the simplified case, then the total amount of time we saved is large. And you can Lambda's law is a bit more complicated than that, and it often is also applied in parallelism, but that's the very basic thing. You have to optimize the parts that take a lot of time, because otherwise you don't see a lot of results. So, and one of the problems there is that in Postgres, there's a lot of parts that you can improve. Usually there's not like a single part where you can see, hey, this part of the system, part I, takes a lot of the time. Usually it's you have a lot of parts, and all of them take up very little time, so it's very hard to see what actually takes up the time. It looks usually looks more like this. And you have some parts that take a bit more time, but then there's also a lot of small parts that take time. So it's not always easy to see where you have to tackle the problem to gain speed up. I started that, my initial idea when in the beginning of the 9.6 cycle was that I would work on batch tuple processing. And to understand what batch tuple processing is, we have to very quickly understand how Postgres actually processes tuples. If you have a, who have here ever seen the explain, has ever seen explain output by Postgres? Or, sorry, the other way around. Who has not seen explain output by Postgres? Okay, and this is like a graphical version that's done by the pgAdmin. It's a bit, for some people, a bit easier to understand, I don't know. If you have, for example, it's not really important what the query does in total here. If you have, for example, a hash join between the orders table and the customers table, traditionally, the way Postgres does this is it scans one row from the orders table, then that row is returned to the hash join node, and then the hash join node tries to probe the customer table, and then we've previously built a hash, but it does so one row checks, then the next row, then the next row, the next row, and every time it finds one where there's a match in the hash join, then it returns that up to the next layer. And then here happens the same thing. It does that one by one by one by one. And that actually is not necessarily very CPU efficient. There's a lot of problems with that. So my initial idea was, hey, I'm going to improve upon that, and I spent like 6 weeks or something on that. Afterwards, my performance benefits were like 3%. Was I had a bunch of like artificial benchmarks where it's like, hey, yeah, okay, I see 60, 80, 100% performance benefits here. But like once I ran it on actual useful queries, the benefits were largely none. And that's because I actually ended up optimizing something that was not currently really the bottleneck. That's why I brought up Arnold's law before. This is something that is architecturally bad, but we have two other things that are even worse. So that's why it didn't really help a lot. So if we, one, the benchmark I ended up using for some of this, because just because it was handy enough, is TPCH. And this is one example query from TPCH. And it's not really that important what it does in detail. The important part for performance analysis here is it does a select, and then it does a lot of aggregates over one table. There could be a bunch of joins, but it doesn't really matter. And the first thing that I noticed after staring at it like for a couple weeks was that we actually do a lot of these aggregate computations. And we ended up that the way Postgres works is that if you compute an aggregate, it evaluates the value of the argument to the aggregate, and then it does call so-called transition function for each of the aggregates once it finds a new row in the same group or group by. And what we do at the moment, or in 9.6 and earlier, is that we compute the value of this expression separately from this expression, separately from this expression, separately from this expression, and so on. And it turned out that sometimes if you do a lot of work in a lot of small pieces, it's smaller than if you do the same amount of work in one big chunk, because like there's some optimization efficiencies you can gain by doing repetitive work only once. So the first thing that I tried to do was to just compute all of the arguments to the transition values one by one. And then there's also some other optimizations that we ended up doing. But those were important to do because otherwise we just hit that as a bottleneck. To see the query. The query, if you look at the query, this is the textual explain output from that query. We can see that the actual scan of the line item table, which is what we select from, takes in total on this roughly 4.5 seconds. And by the way, you can see how old this benchmark is. But the total amount of time in the query is like 19 seconds. So obviously, the scanning the data is not actually the largest part of where we spend time. It's also not the sorting at the end, because we only return four rows. That sorting four rows obviously doesn't take a lot of time. So nearly all of the time is spent in the hash aggregate. So the time spent in the hash aggregate was largely spent in two parts. One is evaluating this list of arguments to the aggregates, and the other one was that the hash part, that the hash aggregate actually has to do like a hash table and do the aggregation. And optimizing those two together like already yielded quite a bit of speed ups. And that was important because otherwise I couldn't see the later performance benefits. If you compare 9.6 with master as of that release version, that's like 2 weeks ago. And I will explain in a second why I used 2 weeks ago. Then we can see that a lot of queries improve a fair bit, especially the long running ones, and some smaller ones, there's very little benefit. To see the as a percentage, we can see that some queries improve tremendously, others are a bit slower. And it turned out that one query here is slower, but that's actually an unrelated change. I haven't yet figured out where that is. So for one query, we have a 9.6 regression. Oh, Robert says it was him.
No,
okay.
Mostly accidentally.
Okay. So yeah, we have some small regression that we have to fix. But so we can see that even with these relatively simple changes, we can already see quite substantial performance improvements. But it's still not that great. By the way, this is all TPCH, and I run these in non-parallelized mode, just because then the timings are a lot more reproducible, because you don't have to start new processes and stuff like that. And I ran it on scale 5 because I wanted to do it memory resident, and I worked on this on a flight, and so I only had my laptop available. Even after that, we spent roughly 60% of the remaining time over the total of expression evaluation. If you spend 60% of the total time in expression evaluation, that's actually a very, very juicy target for optimization. It was very hard to see that we spent all of this time in expression evaluation, because that's not just one function. We do it, we've spread it over hundreds of functions or dozens of functions. So where do we use expression evaluation? We use it for evaluating the target list of a query, and the target list is of a query is like this list here of columns in a, or of expressions in a select list, evaluation of where clauses, like where foo equals whatever or smaller or whatever, and group by clauses, and a lot of other places. So this is a very central thing. And the way it previously worked is that we had basically a tree of expressions. There was, there was supposed to be an expression over there. I don't know. This is something like an expression which I had written there. Where, oh, yeah. I don't know. No, I think it was black. But it was like where A smaller than or bigger than something, and B equal or and B smaller than something. So what you end up with, we first, the top level expression was an AND expression, then we had a function call or and another function call, and then we had that function call had to evaluate its argument, and one of them evaluated a scala var, which is like A, and one of them had evaluated the constant expression, which would be, I don't know, smaller than some date, for example. And then that once these arguments have been evaluated, then the function result could have been compared. The function result would be the smaller or bigger or equals operator, and so on. So that was relatively expensive, because we basically recursed through this tree, we walked the tree, and that's something that's relatively easy to implement, but it's not very good for performance on a modern CPU. So before, we did basically the tree walk. Every of these expressions here, exec evil and so on, was set as a callback. And that was one of the problems why it's hard to see where the time is actually spent, because we call them via callback. So the time is spent, spread over all of these different functions, and there's no top level entry that makes it hard discernible which one it is. And it was recursive, which meant that we spent a lot of time, energy walking on the stack on the CPU level. Or what I tried to do is to convert this expression evaluation from this tree walk based into translating it into an opcode format, like basically what Python does internally, and all these, a lot of these languages, they translate the data structures into a more suitable format for execution. And that resulted that we don't do any callbacks in the common case anymore. We can remove a lot of the jumps by doing some low-level trickery. And one, and very importantly, it's not recursive anymore. So if, unless we have like subqueries, and we, everything is evaluated at the same level in the stack, and that means we can remove a lot of checks, and it means we are actually more efficient. So the results of that, and that's based on top of the previous optimizations, and so that's still the 2 weeks ago, and then def llvm off is basically my development snapshot as of a couple of days ago. This has now been integrated as of Saturday into Postgres, so this could now be actually master, but I didn't want to update my slides for that because there will be later version with additional patches. So we can see that we have another, 30-something percent of the improvements on some queries, and we have 40. And here we can see that in that version of my patch, we had a small regression in query number 5. That's since been resolved, but I would left it in here because it's actually like very, very easy to optimize for a lot of the cases, but then have regressions in some smaller cases. But what this means that we could, using this newer expression evaluation framework, we could save a lot of time for the queries where we spend a lot of time in the expression work. But after all, I said earlier that we spend like roughly in the end 60% of the time in expression evaluation. Even if you make expression evaluation 40% faster or 70% faster, the total we still spend most of the time in expression evaluation. So all of this is nice and great, and it's obviously a good result for Postgres 10, but we could do a lot more to optimize. So what after we were, I did the best I could making expression evaluation faster, and after a while I just couldn't find easy ways to make it any faster, and that's pretty typical. If you look at a lot of the languages, after you can only do so much with interpretation. After that, the overhead of interpretation itself is pretty high. So the next thing to do would be to remove interpretation and generate native programs. And what does native programs means basically? We basically compile the where clause or whatever we have into a program and then run that natively without having any interpretation. So we don't have to do any like check what the next instruction is, and if the next instruction is that and that, then do that and that. And these if it's that, then do that checks, they're pretty expensive in comparison to doing it natively. And the other thing is that if you have these virtual instructions in an interpretation framework, then you have a lot of indirect jumps. And modern CPUs are very good executing things fast if they know what the next thing would be, but they're very bad if they don't know exactly what comes afterwards, and that's the case in interpretation. So just-in-time compilation is the thing to do, and you always, every one of you probably uses just-in-time compilation daily because all your browsers, all the JavaScript that's executed, or the majority of the JavaScript that you execute on in your browsers, if you use some website, is actually just-in-time compiled to be faster because they hit the same thing. They couldn't make JavaScript any faster when run interpreted, so they had to do just-in-time compilation. And they also have a bunch of very familiar problems, namely that they can't just always do just-in-time compilation because the overhead of doing just-in-time compilation is pretty high, so you don't want to do that unconditionally. Instead, you only really want to do that only when it's actually the time spent doing this additional work minus the time saved is actually negative. And it's not really not just for these expressions where you could use just-in-time compilation, there's a lot of additional places. So I implemented a basic just-in-time compilation framework with using LLVM. I don't know whether any of you have heard of LLVM. It's basically a framework for to build compilers. If you ever used the CLang compiler, used Xcode on OS X, or used Swift from Apple for any development, that's all based on the LLVM framework, and then some additional work, and I wanted to reuse that because I don't think it's a good idea to develop a separate compiler framework inside Postgres. I initially started without using LVM, doing all directly, but it's not something we could actually maintain. The amount of work would be too high. So I set out to do this with LLVM, and basically I used this expression evaluation framework that I previously developed, because that also allows for a lot easier just-in-time compilation, and turned that into then added optional just-in-time compilation. As you can see, the performance improvements are again pretty nice. If you compare just that's the new expression evaluation framework, and then on top of that, the JIT is another 40%, and that's after the improvement. So that's like the relative improvement is pretty large. But even afterwards, you spend a lot of time in expression evaluation, so there's still a lot of optimization potential, and I'll come to that in a second. And what you can see here already is that in query 11, which if you look at the total amount of time, which is very short in comparison to the rest, just-in-time compilation is actually negative. What I did here is I set the thresholds for just-in-time compilation to just always do just-in-time compilation, because that's A, easier, and B, allowed me to show this. And I also ran this benchmark without parallelization. And if you then enable parallelization, the times in general obviously get a lot lower because we spend a lot less time. And you can see that for some queries, just-in-time compilation still is a good benefit. But you can also see that for some others, the benefit is already like pretty negative. Looking at this, it's generally if the queries are taking very short amount of time after just-in-time compilation, then the performance benefit of doing just-in-time compilation is like negative. So again, this is with this artificial setting of always doing just-in-time compilation, which you obviously wouldn't want to run in production. But I just wanted to include this because just-in-time compilation is a nice tool for long-running queries, but it's a really bad tool for very short-running queries. And parallel query is only interesting here because it allows to turn relatively long-running queries into shorter-running queries. And I wanted to plug that because that's one other big avenue for making Postgres fast is generally parallel query, and I think Robert is doing a talk about that tomorrow. So there's a lot of more going on than just this. And so I think the framework is pretty good. We have to do a lot more intelligence when to actually do just-in-time compilation, and that's work that's not going to be in Postgres 10, because I already spent a lot of time doing the framework thing that gave the previous benefits, but this one is probably another couple months of work, and unfortunately, time is quite limited. So that's stuff where I know pretty well where we want to go, and I think I really want to get the just-in-time compilation into Postgres 11. After that, I'll want to talk a bit about what further optimization I can see, and in similar vein, but so has anybody questions so far? Okay. So one other bottleneck that I see in a lot of query and that various people in this room have already complained about, and various forks of Postgres spend a good amount of time trying to make faster, is the so-called tuple deforming. And what that basically is, we store tuples in some format on disk, but that on disk is somewhat how dense argue about, but it's denser than the representation we use in memory. And this if it occurs, every row that we actually read from disk or has been filtered by an index. Has been filtered by an index, needs to be converted from this on-disk format into an in-memory format, and that's something that thus happens for analytics queries a lot of times because we process a lot of rows. So that's something we have to optimize a lot. And it's a similar thing that with the expression evaluation. It's currently very slow because it's very hard to predict for the CPU because we obviously have to deal with tables of each type of format. Sometimes you have tables with only one column, sometimes with multiple columns, different types, different widths. So that's actually like pretty hard to do in a very fast manner. I spend a lot of time, like more than a month of actual time, not like with even with excluding interruptions, and I managed to speed it up by 3% and adding 1,000 lines of code, so that turned out not to be that great. So I think that's another one where you have to do just-in-time compilation, because unless somebody comes up with a great idea how to make this faster without just-in-time compilation, I wasn't able to, and a bunch of other people that tried weren't able to do a lot about it either. So I think there we need to do just-in-time compilation as well. And the speedups, I have a very preliminary patch that doesn't handle every corner case, so it's not actually ready yet. But we like the deforming part itself gets up to 80% faster, which is like a pretty beefy improvement. Even if we like obviously the total amount of time the query gets faster, it won't be 80% because we don't spend all the time in the tuple deforming. And one thing here that's pretty important is that I'm currently optimizing basically one particular benchmark, which is called TPCH. And it's a benchmark from, I don't know, 96, I think, something like that, which is probably not the best representation of the workloads you guys run into. So if you have workloads where your queries are too slow, please, please, please tell the community what you're doing and what's too slow. Because otherwise, we are optimizing workloads that are not actually representative of what people are doing, and that's not really helpful to either you or me, because I wasted my time and you wasted your time upgrading Postgres. Are you okay? You wasted your time upgrading Postgres, and it's not faster after all, even if you promised, hey, we made this type of query a lot faster, but because we didn't optimize for your queries, it wasn't actually faster. So please, if you have workloads where your performance is where query performance is a bottleneck, please tell the community, say, hey, I'm doing this, this is too slow. If you can provide benchmarks of what's actually too slow, we can tell you how to get that data, please come to us and tell us about that, because otherwise we won't improve what you're doing. In general,
where should we come to you? Specifically to do that?
There's the PostgreSQL hackers mailing list. You can either mail me, on the last slide I'll have my email address, or the general Postgres mailing list. If you just search Postgres and mailing list, you'll find the right one, or you can search for my name and it'll also pop up and I can forward it. Just as an informal poll, who here runs into performance problems with queries in Postgres? So like roughly the half, okay. Please, at least a third of you, come back and tell us what's too slow. And my hope is not really that I personally implement the just-in-time compilation for tuple deforming for everything else, because there's only so much time I can spend on it. But my goal is basically to get into Postgres 11, the framework for doing just-in-time compilation in Postgres, and then other people, including hopefully some people here in the room, will start using just-in-time compilation in further parts of Postgres. So as I said like three slides ago or something, that my just-in-time compilation still spends a lot of time for a lot of queries in expression evaluation. And that's not really because of the fault of just-in-time compilation. That's the fault because my just-in-time compilation is stupid. Because it was a lot of work, but what I did was, it was not. Okay, whatever. What I basically did is I had this tree of expressions earlier where we walked at that point like recursively. Then for the fast expression evaluation, we did converted that to a linear form, and then that I translated just to a native program and ran that. But that means that there's a lot of function calls in there, because Postgres, which is very extensible. You can add new data types at runtime. You can do create extension, which creates a new data type. So a lot of the stuff is done in a very extensible manner, but that also has some performance overhead. For example, if you have a where clause that says where A plus B is smaller than C, what that will result in is an expression that first says, get me this column from the table, then do call float 8 or int 4 or whatever plus operator with another one that you get from the table, and then you run the operation float 8 or whatever data type less than, and another column in the database. And so for this expression, we already like do like two function calls. And these function calls are actually not generally necessary. If there's a built-in types into Postgres, we could actually provide the just-in-time compiler with information that about this data type. And then that data type could actually just be inlined in the compiled program. And that's actually possibly a lot faster because the operation of adding two floating point numbers in a CPU, you can do that a lot of times a second. But the overhead with the function call takes about roughly 1,000 times longer than if you were to just do it in line. I mean, part of that is because we have to do some error handling that we probably would have to do still afterwards because we still have to detect like overflows. But in a lot of cases, a lot of the overhead can just be optimized away. But the problem for that is that then we have to tell our just-in-time compiler, namely LLVM, how this function is actually defined. So we have to develop a framework how to tell LLVM how all of our internal functions are defined, which is actually not impossible because LLVM has this, or C-Lang together have this nice feature that you can generate just-in-time compile-ready code for all of these functions, and then you can load them into memory at the start of Postgres, and then Postgres, and then when it does just-in-time compilation, could actually inline all of those. One of the big problems here is our extensibility. It's quite possible to do this for the built-in types. It's a lot harder to develop a framework where we can do this for external data types. If you, for example, wanted to do, I don't know which extension you guys use frequently, I don't know, PostGIS, and you want to do PostGIS just-in-time compilation, I think it's not particularly good target for just-in-time compilation, but it's the most common data type I could come up with. Then we wouldn't know this definition of this type. So that's one of the big challenges of how we can do this in a way that can be used by extensions. Similar and more importantly for average and expressions similar like that, we call, if there's an expression average, we call extract this column, we extract this column, then call the plus operator for the data type, and then we call for each row that's in the group, we call the average accumulator, which basically internally just adds up the sum and the count. And then at the end, once we have evaluated all the values inside the group for this expression, then we call the result of that, which will then do the result computation. And it's probably I think it's relatively easy to see that usually the performance will be either like the most of the time it's spent in either the plus operator and the average accumulator because the final result usually there will not be that many different groups, so you'll only call that a relatively low number of times. So one big thing would be to call the accumulator inline that, because that's also like if you just think about what you would need to do for average, you need to add the current one to the count of rows, you need to add the value to the sum of rows, and that's it. That's really, it's like 15 instructions or something if you do it right. But at the moment, we spend a lot more time of it because of function call overhead and some other internal details. One of the big problems here is that the way Postgres calls functions is actually relatively complicated because we have to support calling function with a nearly arbitrary number of arguments. And CPUs don't really do that, so we have a lot of weird overhead of that. We support functions that return multiple rows as a result. That the C doesn't really allow that, so we have a lot of framework around calling functions. So that's a lot of overhead that we could optimize away in the optimized cases. And generally, we could also just generate beta code because the code I'm generating right now is really like simplistic. There's a lot of immediate values, if that tells anybody what we have pointer values embedded in the program code, and we can do a lot more of that. So I really hope that we have another good chunk of performance benefits after this. Then I can, after this, we can actually go back to what I started with. We can do batch tuple processing, because after all these optimizations, then finally, my initial guess where our overhead was is actually turns out to be true. We have the overhead then becomes that we do these one by one tuple processing through the query tree. But that's a bit out, because we have to first get this just-in-time compilation stuff done. And I have a very early, my earlier prototype from the beginning that initially got 3%. After applying it on top of all these changes, I got in some queries 0%, because that's just still not the bottleneck. In other percent, I got another 40% of the performance improvement on top of that. So there's a lot of optimization potential there. And I'm pretty sure that there's a lot more ideas than just the stuff that I came up with. Yeah. Oh, I thought there was an email in there. Okay, it's just my name on at Citus Data. I thought I had the email there, but I don't. Yeah, I think that's all I had to talk about. Any questions? Yes.
So now we do maintain
kind of
two code bases.
Yes.
Side by side. Is there any idea of indicating meaning
in the execution plan, which so far I tried a bunch.
What's the question,
Andreas? Oh, okay. So the question is whether an observation was that it looks like we need to keep both the interpreted version of the code around, because we have to do the current version of code expression evaluation, because just-in-time compilation is not always suitable, and we have to do the optimized one because the interpreted version is not always suitable. So, and then the question, I think, which...
the question was, I mean, especially from my standpoint, from debugging and stuff, will there be any way for me to know which path is taken? So if something is funny, you know, acting funny sometimes, not another, I can go, oh, it's going down the just-in-time path, and maybe there's an issue there, or...
I think it would be relatively straightforward to show that in explain, or in, well, not in explain, but in explain analyze, or it, but so far I've experimented with two ways to determine whether to use just-in-time compilation. One is you could just set a cost factor, like every query that's bigger, like more expensive than these many cost units gets everything just-in-time compiled. Or the other one was every expression that got called more than n number of times gets just-in-time compiled. Both of these have some advantages. The latter one has the advantage that we only do just-in-time compilation for the expression that we actually call frequently instead of the other stuff, which only gets called once. But it has the disadvantage that we do the slow one for a number of times. But we could easily indicate that in the explain analyzed output, because that gets the post-execution query tree.
Final comment. I was saying it seems like there's a real potential for divergence where the two algorithms are not acting exactly the same, and you would want to know when that,
so
which path you're following, maybe.
I sure hope not. I started out with like adding assertions to every time you evaluate an expression. It's all like with just-in-time compilation. It's also done using not just-in-time compilation, and then results are compared and overall regression tests, and the same for tuple deforming. Because I was very afraid of that, but the algorithms should not diverge at all. But who knows?
I assume the tuple deforming jitting could be done either at boot time or then cached and updated after every table DDL and used across many queries.
So it's not necessarily easily possible to do this across process boundaries. So you do it, what I did was I cached it in the process for the common case, but we also do deforming entire levels of the query tree. For example, if you do a hash join, and then we store like the compressed version of the tuple inside the hash table, then we do need to deform that again after the query. That one is not easily cacheable. So, but yeah.
So if you have a long running backend though, you would cache across multiple queries essentially.
Yes. So far, I didn't even bother to implement like a limit of that cache size, because like the compile functions are really small, actually. Like usually, you end up with like I don't know, 300 bytes or something. So that's not actually like that important, but probably over the longer run, you should probably implement like, hey, these you're allowed to keep that many cached things around. I haven't thought too much about that, honestly.
Hello. Do you think there's a lot of potential for ahead of time compilation using the same framework, perhaps during statement preparation?
So at the moment, all the just-in-time stuff is tied to execution time things. I think that's a really bad thing. We should do it so we can actually cache all this at prepare time. Whether I would still probably not do it like unconditionally, because even for prepared statements, a lot of that time you execute them only once. A lot of the expressions in a prepared statement are not actually executed frequently. So we still want some intelligence when to do it, but we definitely should be able to cache that inside the prepared statement so we only do it on the first execution or something. Yeah, I think we should do that. I don't quite know all the details how to do that yet.
Okay, thank you.
Computers these days have so many cores, it's hard to keep all of them busy, even with parallel queries and things like that. So I'm wondering if there's any idle time left over among your cores. Might it make sense to, when you encounter a new expression during execution, actually start down both paths and see which one gives the answer faster for that particular iteration? Meanwhile, perhaps some lower priority, you know, the code generation thread can continue generating your code in the in a JIT fashion, and then the next time around your code might be already ready, and effectively get your JIT for free instead of having to pay a penalty up front or having to store it somewhere, things like that. I wonder if that's a viable
that's
idea.
I think that's a longer term thing that might be beneficial. I think there's a lot of things that make that actually non-trivial, because like I said, like the one process's memory layout might not be the same as another process's. So there's like one function might only exist in the current backend because it has been created in the current transaction. So there's a lot of complexities around detecting when exactly to do that. But I think I don't think we're likely to do the try to execute the jitted one and the non-jitted one in parallel. But the idea that we would start jitting in a separate process and then use the jitted one once it's ready, I think that has some merit. It also has some associated runtime overhead, because you need to set every now and then check, hey, can I replace this function now with the jitted version once the jitted stuff is ready? But I think that's something, but I think there's a lot of things that have to be done before, because there's a it's a very relatively advanced thing, and we're not there yet.
With regard to function calls such as substring on a string or extract the year from a date time, do you feel we'll actually get to a point where we could just-in-time compile those particular functions in there so we don't have the function call and just eliminate it overall for the most commonly used?
I think for a very common one, yes. I think what my current idea is basically when to compile Postgres, we go through all the functions that are defined. Postgres knows which those are, and then use CLang to extract the, I don't know whether how much you would know about the, extract the bitcode, put that in the catalog, and then inline that. I think there will have some size restrictions, because it doesn't make sense to inline a function that calls half of the backend for relatively obvious reasons. But yes, I think we definitely want to do that. I'm not sure, I think it's unlikely that you see a benefit on substring, just on that's the overhead of the function call itself is not where the most of the time is spent.
Okay.
But for like plus, smaller, and stuff like that, we definitely should do that.
Thanks.
So in one of the slides you are mentioning, right, like for expression comparison, right, it has to work not only with the default data type, but with the custom data type as well. So why can't we have two separate paths, one path for default data types and another for custom data type, where it may be expensive for the custom data type, So
we could definitely do that. One of the problems is that it adds like adds a bunch of code duplication. If we start going down that path, I would rather start have like a generic solution that's usable both by in-core data types and by external data types. If you can't figure out a way to do that, I'll definitely think we'll like. I personally think I'm pretty sure that some other people in the community will disagree. We'll have to hard code operations for like the very common data types int, float, int 4, int 8, float 4, float 8. I think though, if you inline the operations for those, you already see a lot of benefit. Mm-hmm. I think that's potentially something we have to do. I would rather have a generic solution. We'll
I mean, like any generic solution is going to add a cost for the additional cost, right? A little bit, maybe.
Not necessarily. If we do just-in-time compilation and we have the definition of the, like, an inlineable definition of the function, and then there's no difference whether it's an in-core or an external data type anymore. Mm-hmm. So in that case, we're good. It obviously would only work if, like, at in the extension, you would provide the definition of that inlineable definition. Mm. But I mean, if your extension doesn't take advantage of that, then I have no problem making it slower, because then we can't do magic.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
The approach that you describe here is this very carefully crafted, conscious kind of approach where you're targeting specific features of the expression. I wonder if a more blind approach might also bear fruit. And what I have in mind is to just write the entire expression evaluator in a language that would compile down to P code. I mean, where I'm thinking is how Java works. And then have your virtual machine, which has JIT built into it, just pick up and speed up as it goes. And that we'd have less work and less specific things to try to do at the level where you're working on. I don't know if that comparison has been thought about or attempted.
So I think it's a bit more closer to what you actually describe in reality, but it's like we have this machine code, like this opcode-based language for interpretation, and then we translate that one into the compiled one. And so that is like, it's basically we translate it into something like Java's bytecode, and then do JIT on that. So that's actually kind of similar. I don't think we would do something like doing that on a very granular path. Like with Java, you can, with some JVMs, you can do that like on individual loop basis where you can optimize those and only do just-in-time compilation on those. I don't think we want to go there, because the overhead of having to detect when to do that is, and like to count whether it's worthwhile, it's actually noticeable. But
I
think the dispatch overhead is way too high. So like, we're just talking about very few, like in total, relatively few cycles. If you go like enter a JVM or something, the like will already be slower than the interpreted version. Like unless you have a humongous expression, and then the JVM couldn't easily call back into Postgres functions. So I don't like using existing there framework like. I don't see that.
More abstract, it's to be like an embedded JVM kind of thing that where if your C or C++ would continue along, then you drop into this part.
Yeah. We can talk about it later, but I don't think it's likely, but maybe you have a better idea than I.
I think that's all the time we have time for, so.
Okay.
Well, thank you.